Santiago Garcia Sanz, the localization quality assurance supervisor in the company, and he's going to talk about the challenges that they're facing in the localization and how they solved it with Manuel.
So thank you so much for your kind introduction, and thank you for being here today. So I try to make it as easy and as simple as possible. It's a pleasure for us as Keyboard Studio Spain to be here. I would like to talk, first of all, about us, so who we are. So as the name may suggest, we are Keyboard Studios, a localization site operating from Spain, and we're currently working in four different languages, mostly Castilian Spanish, Latin American Spanish, Brazilian Portuguese, and also European Portuguese. And I would like you to give you some figures for you to have some context about our activity in our company. So according to our latest production report, we had over 4,000 transactions last month, over 230 live ongoing projects. We delivered over 3.2 million words, and we used over 120 translators with 17 language localization PMs. Our setup, we work mainly on the MemoQ server 2015, and we share our server with our Keyboard Studio sites, but some of our clients, like we saw with the Frontier example before us, they have their own MemoQ servers, and we log onto the servers and contribute to their projects. And as for projects, what do we have? We mostly deal with video games, as I already mentioned, but we might distinguish between non-game projects or non-game requests, including patch notes, messages to players, newsletters, blog posts, game trailers, tweets, even comic books, novels, strategy guides, or even if you are following the latest trends in the industry. So esports are a thing, and yeah, we get to translate for this kind of events as well. And also we've got game requests, and the games we usually deal with, they may range from modest indie developments to big AAA games. If you are not familiar with the size of a video game project, so let's say a AAA may have up to 1 million words, or if you are dealing with audio, maybe up to 50,000 audio strings, so they are quite complex projects. And they, of course, involve both text translation and audio recording. The usual formats we deal with for non-game, these include Word documents, HTML files as well, Excel files, TXT files, and also subtitles. I was quite happy to attend to the presentation this morning, because we've been dealing, I will refer to this later on, but we had to design a specific process for us to be able to complete the subtitles, because all the content we translate, so for videos, they need to be consistent with in-game content. So we need to translate our subtitles in MemoQ, and then we have been formatting them using a different tool, a different solution before delivering to the client. So challenges of this type of requests or projects. Above all, the frequency we receive a lot of microtransactions with really, really short turnaround times. So maybe just translate this tweet and I need it back in 20 minutes or 30 minutes time. So it takes actually more time to process the whole request than getting the translation done. Also, versioning, for instance, with patch notes, we see that time and time again that we get updates on the fly. So we need to stop production, re-import the new file, and retrieve the statistics again and keep on translating. Also, what I call here the in-game consistency versus the marketing touch. As you may probably know, marketing content is most of times dealt with by a different department. So you've got the developers or the publishers, and you've got the marketing people, and they just say, okay, I don't like this approach, so you need to be consistent with my guidelines. So you need to pay attention to the style, to the terminology, even things may end up differently in-game and in marketing because of lack of communication between developers and the marketing people. Also, as I said, asset finalization, if you need to complete the requests or to conduct checks outside of MemoQ. For instance, in our experience, the spell check is also a problem, and completing the spell check within MemoQ doesn't work for us, so we most of the times just export a bilingual RTF file and get it done in Microsoft Word. And of course, translation memory creation, which is, I mean, just editing your TM for consistency. As for our game projects, the usual approach is, as we already saw, so I don't go into to reinvent the wheel now. We work in batches. Our assets are usually released for translation gradually, so once the different text drops have been locked by the developers. Also, in our experience, if you are doing full localization, so both text translation in audio recording, audio scripts usually precede the user interface translation because scripts need to be adapted and need to be recorded and QA'd. And also, they also precede user manual or box text, so the packaging. Also, as I just said, text adaptation prior to recording. So we may finish a translation of a given script, and this text then goes to an artistic director who will prepare the file before recording. Once the assets have been recorded, we get the so-called ASREC or final scripts, and these are going to be used as they are, they are going to be dumped as game subtitles. And this is something we've seen, especially for the PEGI or the ESRB compliance. If you need to decide if your game is going to be a PEGI 3 or PEGI 7 or PEGI 12 or 16 or whatever, so you need to send the whole text for them to check whether if you are using any swear words or whatever, and depending on the language you use and other factors as well, but also language you use, you will be given a different rating. So, in our experience as well, user interface translation usually is overlapping with the LQA testing, so sometimes you've got developers testing, so they're conducting the LQA testing, the assets, so it's some sort of back and forth as well with the production team and with the testing team. And also, probably worth mentioning as well, the user manuals, they got a particular layout, and we need to pay attention to formatting and stuff. So, challenges. This was already mentioned in the previous presentation, but audio scripts, they are subject to different constraints. You may have different applicable length restrictions depending on if you're translating cinematics or AI text or whatever. So something would be the most restrictive one, the one closest to traditional films or TV shows. I place here this strange TC plus minus X percent. That means your localized version may be a little bit longer or a little bit shorter than the source text. So, but if you're dealing with audio, you can tell for sure how long your translation will take, but you may guess, depending on the usual speed of the voice talent, how long they will take for them to render the acting. And we may have also wild restrictions, which actually means so no restriction at all, but big issues because audio takes space in the hard drive or in the Blu-ray disc, so you need to control how long you are. And you may end up overlapping different audio strings if you don't use caution. So, user interface is also subject to length restrictions, and it's particularly important in mobile games, mobile titles, because your smartphone screens are just that big and you need to fit your translation. Other challenges, tight deadlines and staggered deliveries. So most of times, if we need to comply to meet a given deadline, we need to expedite editing. So we may request our translators to just to deliver. We slice the files and they deliver some slices and review starts, the kicks in for us to be able to meet the deadline, and also for the editor to be able to give feedback to translators in case we need to change the approach, for instance. We also mentioned before, our colleagues mentioned before, the use of variables and concatenations. So we need to know which values variables are going to take for grammar consistency, for instance. Otherwise you may end up with a female gender string with a male value, and that wouldn't work in Spanish, at least. Lack of context. We do use queries a lot. We send them the client's way, and indeed, sometimes we don't get a prompt answer, but what we try to do is to re-deliver. So it's some sort of agile process at our end as well, because, we received the answers. We have delivered this file 2 days ago, but we need to check the new information and go through the files to see whether re-delivery is in order. Another challenge, some projects may require gender lines. English is an easy language to work with, but sometimes you may have a project requiring a female variant of a given sentence to actually work in your target protocol. And also, one of our biggest challenges, especially for TM consistency, is that we end up with updates to assets by multiple stakeholders. I already mentioned the job of the artistic directors with the ASREC scripts, but sometimes you also have the LQA testers modifying the assets at their end, and you need to retrieve the whole text up again and check whether the changes have been made or not for you to be able to keep track of everything. So, our tricks, which is probably the core of the presentation. We are not that lucky to have always such nice clients as Frontier preparing and doing all the stuff at their end. So sometimes we just receive from the assets from a content manager or management tool, and we need to do the preparation ourselves. Our approach will depend on the project, it will depend on the content management system used by the client. But what I can say is that the multilingual limited text filter that we saw yesterday in the masterclass is your friend, so you've got to love that filter. And it is really useful even if you're following a monolingual approach. Another trick, just don't be shy, cascade a Rex filter and save your configuration, because maybe you will be using a different approach for every different client, but you will expect all assets coming from a given client in the same file structure. So you may reuse, especially if you're dealing with this Japanese publisher using not that user-friendly Excel files with 20 or 40 different tabs. So it really saves time. So why the Rex filter? Because you will need to protect the non-translatable content, tags, placeholders, whatever. So it's really useful to devote some time for you to expedite your production in the end. Also, slice your files if you need to meet a tight deadline, and allow the reviewer to step in earlier in the production process. And also, don't be shy, invest in your project and QA settings. Pay attention to your TV, because it will save your life in the end. And always do your run QA to detect any problems you may have. Our pending problems. So MemoQ is a super nice tool, but we've been having some troubles with especially big files. With big files, for instance, last year we were dealing with a 4 million word project, and we received the whole text base in a single file. So it was madness. And we had to manually split the text into 10 different files and upload it into 10 different projects. Otherwise, we wouldn't be able to handle it. Also, for heavy-loaded projects, MemoQ may have some performance issues. With heavy-loaded, I'm talking projects above maybe 300,000 words, 400,000 words. And why are you using a single project for this? Because we need to keep track of everything we've been translating so far, and our projects may last for months or maybe years. I recall a project we ended up working at for almost 1 year and a half. Also, I mentioned that yesterday in the masterclass as well. We would love to have, so this is a special request also for Kilgrey. We would love to have our comments logged in MemoQ, exported back to Excel. That would help us a lot, for instance, to identify queries, to send them the client's way, and also those lines that will need a female variant. And another problem, which is also related to the heavy loaded projects I mentioned before, is that slices files with repetitions assigned to multiple users are tricky if you need to properly assess the actual contribution of the different vendors to the project, because you might end up with translator one doing most of the work and translators two and three and benefiting from it and just confirming repetitions. So that's an issue. And we would be able to conduct a post-translation analysis if we handled this with a project on a file basis, but that's not an option for us at the moment. And also, it's not written here, but I just recalled, especially with non-game requests, what may be useful for us would be MemoQ being able to open files from different projects at the same time. Because you may receive two, three, four different requests, rush requests from different clients, and if we were able to not close all projects once you are done, and you would be able to open up or to retrieve different files from different projects at the same time in a single session, that would be possible. I know MemoQ does not work in this way, so we keep closing and opening up projects as required. And Yeah, also, we had more problems before we got here, but I would like to thank the really nice and helpful people of Kingry for the master classes, because for instance, in the SDK and the API master class, we heard of the possibility of having specific QA checks if you've got in a single segment multiple lines with different character limitations, and being able to check that and see, okay, well, your third line is exceeding the limit by 5 characters. That's something I didn't know it was possible to get with a special development, so we'll definitely need to investigate that road with our engineering department. Also, the possibility of somebody talked about that in the master class as well. So, to develop a software solution for improved concordance searches or to update your TMs without locking them out for all the users in a project. So, with the resources API, that's something we will need to check as well. Also, we really liked the video preview for subtitles, even if we don't expect this feature to allow us to discontinue subtitle editing software, but at least it will be an improvement for what our clients or some of our clients call proof listening. They say, okay, you received a translation, but I want your subtitles to actually match the audio, not the transcript you've received. And that's something we've learned over the years. You can't blindly trust your developer or your client. They may not be providing you with perfect assets, but they expect your translation to be perfect. And also, something I really liked a lot is that so far, at least in MMOQ 2015, whenever you used the multilingual limited text filter and you imported multiple columns as context, you just had some boring ID, and now with the latest version you get the column name, and you actually know this is the string ID, this is maybe a character speaking, and the audience they are talking to, so you will benefit from this improved preview of the multilingual filter. And that's everything I had to mention today, so if you've got any questions, I will be happy to answer them. I agree with my colleague from Frontier. Machine translation may be an option for non-creative text. I think it needs post-editing at this stage, or to some extent, but even for some basic messages like the server will be down for maintenance from 2 to 4. These kind of messages could easily be translated with machine translation. So that's something we don't do at the moment, or don't do on a day-to-day basis. But I've already heard discussions about that, and that's something maybe we should be prepared to react to, at least. So who knows what the future has for everyone in this room, but yeah, that's something you hear more and more.
Anybody else? We still have a couple of minutes for questions. No? Yes.
Hi. Sorry, I have a really boring on-game organization question. You mentioned that you also translate into Latin American Spanish.
Yeah.
I've been always wondering, what is this language based on? Which language variety is it based on?
Yeah.
Are there any rules to codify or something like that?
No, it's a really interesting question, because Latin American Spanish does not exist, so it's an invented variety. So it's like the neutral Spanish, and that's something some clients or some publishers tried to work with in the past, and it had a really negative reception in Spain, in both Spain and Latin America. So as for Latin or Latin American Spanish, we mostly record in Mexico. So as far as games goes, the usual recording studios are based either in Mexico or in Argentina. And let's say that the Latin Spanish is just a lighter variety, taking some approaches from Mexico, from Colombia, from Bolivia, from Peru. They don't use the voseo. They don't. They use the single past tense. They try to use word choices which may work, and or at least not be offensive in any territory. So it's some sort of artificial variety, which actually is better received in America than in Spain, for instance.
Thanks, and just a follow-up question. So does that mean that like different vendors, if they translate into American Spanish, that they basically translate maybe into different languages, different varieties? Because you base it on Mexico and something maybe based on Argentina.
But we solve this thing out by providing them with guidelines at the start of the project and telling them, okay, this is what you may use, this is what you don't use for this project. For instance, you may say auto, but not carro, or whatever. And also, as far as grammar goes, it's closer to Mexican Spanish because we are recording in Mexico. So, we also want our voice talents in Mexico to feel comfortable with the script that they have to render as well.
Okay, thank you.
You're welcome.
Oh, other question. I think we still have time for one more question from the game industry.
Thank you. I just wanted to ask that you mentioned that you had a project with I don't know how many million words, and you had to split it up into 10 projects. How did you handle the repetitions, for example? Did you use pre-translation, or did you do some kind of trick and review?
We used the pre-translation, but we got them reviewed. So you can't always, as I said, the gender lines are a problem. So maybe 90% of those lines were okay as they were with repetitions, but maybe the remaining 10% required some edits to generate female variants or whatever. So that's something we do at our company. So we make translate or we make recycle the 100% or 101% matches, but they are always reviewed for consistency reasons.
Thank you.
And thank you, sir. I'm so sorry.
No problem.
Thank you so much for the presentation. Thank you all who came today.